I know.
Every movie we were putting up. Tyrone, can we get Tyrone?
Come on, man.
Come on, Tyrone. Black people, come on, man. We're questioning my blackness. I know. You talk about all this white shit, but you talk about Barbie. Can't get no Tyrone, no. Hey everyone, Double Toasted Live in Atlanta is coming up very soon, September 2nd. Join us for a night of comedy, games, and an after party. We've already sold out of the VIP passes and the all-access tickets. But there's still some tickets available, but it's filling up very quickly. And you're going to want to go because if you've never seen a Double Toasted show, ask anyone at one of our sold-out shows just how much fun it is. Get your tickets now by going to doubletoasted.com, dtmerch.com, or x1entertainment.com. Hey, we'll see you soon.
Tell him, come on, help him.
Him and his clone. Erykah Badu. Yeah, she had a goddamn mind, but Erykah Badu is amazing, though. Inspired the title of a movie with nobody in there's name Tyrone. But this movie's been out for a while, y'all. Don't think I'm not aware of that, but I didn't get a chance to talk about this film right here, which is They Clone Tyrone. Now, I didn't get a chance to talk about this for a particular reason, which I will tell you about, but let's watch this trailer first. I love the trailer for this. I've been wanting to watch this ever since I saw the trailer, and then watched it and didn't talk shit about it at all. But there's a reason, because people are mad at me. They like, every movie review we were putting up, Tyrone, can we get Tyrone?
Come on, man.
Come on, Tyrone.
Black people, come on, man. Come on.
People questioning my blackness. I know. You talk about all this white shit, but you talk about Barbie. Can't get no Tyrone, no.
Crazy.
Everything okay in there, baby?
Oh, shit! Oh, this shit.
Negativity, go give me some goddamn wet. That stomach.
Boy, I gotta tell you something. That freaked me the f- out. There's a lot of freaky shit in this movie. But looking at this white dude with his afro and his afro beard, I was like, what the hell is that?
Right.
That was the weirdest thing in the movie to me.
Oh, this motherfucker did.
Okay, wait, gotta
talk. Like, it ain't no Jufro either. It's kinky.
Uh-huh.
Nappy.
Yeah.
Go get me some goddamn wet nap stumbling for my.
Excuse me, kind sir, but if you could pour me to the elevator.
You know who that dude looks like? That dude with the white dude with the afro keeps popping up. He looks like the dude that's been on our show recently, Julian Emdinger. He looked like Julian Emdinger in the face.
Oh, him right there?
Like, yeah, right there.
He looks like him and Ding?
Yeah, he looks like him and Ding with afro. We got a dude that's on this show kind of looks like this if he had an afro. Nap ass afro.
Sir, but if you could pull me to the
freaking
laboratory.
Don't let the back door hit you.
I'll be out your atmosphere.
Let's get my.
Regardless of what I think of this, this has got to be one of the most unique movie blends of the year. Because this is a little bit of everything. I mean, look, if you're looking for the movie with everything, then go talk to Tyrone, because Tyrone got you. This is a sci-fi, blaxploitation, geek, mystery comedy. And I got to tell you, this has got me internally conflicted, man. You know, because I've always lately have been about less black stereotypes on the screen and more progressive images of blacks in media, especially film. And you don't get no more stereotypical than a pimp, a hoe, and a drug dealer.
Yeah.
And
a gangster.
Yeah. Going on hood adventures.
Yeah.
You know?
I feel you, man.
Yeah. And it don't stop. It don't stop. I mean, everyone in the hood calls each other the N-word. They drink, everybody drinking 40s. I see nobody drink no water. If it wasn't brown, it was purple.
Right,
purple
right,
drink.
Right.
Everybody eating chicken, dancing while they doing it. They shooting each other. I don't think anybody got a job outside of drug dealing, a pimp, and a hoe. If it's outside of that, it's standing on the corner or standing in front of the convenience store. I'm not comfortable with any of this, man. I know people been talking about this movie and they've been loving it, but I'm gonna be the one to tell you, I'm not comfortable with this.
But goddamn, it's a good movie, man. I mean, this is where the conflict comes in. And I get it. As the movie went on, I got it. I kind of got it watching the trailer. But, you know, still being steeped in all these stereotypes.
I know.
Right.
But Jesus, man. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. I'm sitting up here talking about this, but, you know, I like this hoe. I like this pimp. I like this drug dealer. You know, I think the reason why is because these actors are great, because these characters are great. I'm sorry. Sure. These characters are awesome.
They're written very well.
No, they are. These actors are great.
Well, you know, they're hood stereotypes, but they're all quite eloquent and loquacious
in their own hood way.
Yeah.
Like, you know, but the actors are great that are in this. John Boyega as Fontaine, the drug dealer. You know, John Boyega never ceases to amaze me with his range lately. He does a lot of diverse roles right now. Tiana Paris, man, who plays Yo-Yo, the hoe. I love this actor the more I see her, man.
Sure.
She's been on a come up for a while, and she's very good, man. And Jamie Foxx.
Jamie the Goat Foxx.
This might be, a lot of people probably disagree with me on this because they don't think I'm overlooking a lot of things that he's done before, but I think this is one of his best performances in a while. And I say that because this is one of the performances where we get the rare moment where Jamie is not afraid to go stupid.
Yeah.
You know, Jamie's always been smooth. He's always been charismatic. Yeah. He's always been the lead man. He's a stupid ass pimp.
Yeah. Yeah.
he really should get out the game, man.
Right.
Because he's, you know what? The thing is, he's the hoe.
Uh-huh.
And all his hoes pimp him out.
Yeah. He's not that good at his job.
No.
Hell no.
You know, for everything you're saying, when I first started watching this, I had some trouble getting into the characters.
Mm-hmm.
Besides the stereotypes, I was just watching. I was like, okay, John Boyega's, he's a little too pulled back. And he talks a big game, but he's not actually threatening. And then with Tiana Paris as the hoe, I was like, she's a little bit too much. She's a little over the top. Jamie Foxx, I thought, was just right. Mm-hmm. But then once it started to kick into what everything was, what it was about, what was going on, then it all coalesced for me.
Yeah. So this is, if you couldn't tell, because the least said about the movie, the better. There's a lot of surprises because there's so many twists and turns in this film. I think they showed almost too much in the trailer because I'd seen the trailer.
I gave it away.
Yeah. I saw the trailer a long time ago, forgot about a lot of stuff that I'd seen there. And then I watched the movie. That's why we didn't actually do the review, y'all, because I was in Turkey at the time when the movie came out.
Mm-hmm.
And I watched it while I was there and want to talk about it, but I'd rather have somebody like you guys to talk about
with.
And you know, and I just couldn't stop and just talk about it, you know, at the time. So you guys kept asking for it and I saw it, and ever since I saw it, I enjoyed it so much that I wanted to talk about it, and better late than never, which is why we're here right now. But really, you know, the least said about the plot, the better. But as you can tell from the trailer, there is some sort of ghetto hood conspiracy going on where the government or some shadowy organization is infiltrating the hood with all of the things that they think black people like, which is chicken,
hair
care products, especially for them perms that women be getting, grape soda, and church, you know, good old religion. So, you know, this is very much a message movie. But, you know, while watching this, I have to say that, you know, the reason why these characters, and we're going to get into why it's necessary for them to be what they are. But I will say this, the reason why I started loving these characters, what made me fall in love with them the most is that when they, you know, okay, so you got Fontaine who's you know, he's hard. You know, he's playing it tough. Yo-Yo, you know, she's sassy. Jamie just goofy. But, you know, so what's his name? Slick Charles is the pimp's name. Slick Charles is stupid. But when they all get together, they're all a bunch of goofballs.
Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, even hard-ass Fontaine. And it's like, at that point, it's like watching them solve a hood Scooby-Doo mystery.
Scooby-Doo, yeah.
Yeah. All they needed was a pit bull that talks. It's, yeah, man. And they're characters that play into the larger conspiracy message in the movie, which is why I'm saying that this is why we need these stereotypes here, because this is a movie about infiltrating the hood and these things that have created these stereotypes that we see, you know, sometimes in real life. This has created the poverty that, you know, people have come to associate as, with certain kind of stereotypes with. And so with this, while this is done in some sort of absurd sci-fi comedy here, what I love about this is that it does have some historical truth, because what this is really based on is real things that if you don't know about it, in which, you know, shit, some black people don't know their history. Definitely a lot of white people don't know this to this day. But, you know, this is almost in reference to things that seem like a conspiracy, but they're true. Things like drugs being funneled into the inner cities.
Right.
Experiments on black people, especially black men. You know, you can go look at the Tuskegee experiment for that, you know, to see what's happening here. This, you know, this is what it's doing right here. This is what they're kind of addressing. Also, they're being self-critical of black culture, you know, questioning what we put into our bodies and what we do to our bodies.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's a very smart film that almost needed these uncomfortable stereotypes to get across.
You can't just say stuff. You gotta Trojan horse it. you give a dog a pill. You gotta wrap it in some bacon or something.
Yeah.
To get them to eat it.
Yeah. The filmmaking in this is so good, and part of it again kind of lends itself to all the genres that we have here. Because don't think that this is hitting you heavy on the head. Don't think this is hitting you hard with the message that we're just talking about right here. You know, there's a lot of things going on here in this movie. Where we said, you know, again, this is a mixture of many genres. So while it is a message film, while it is, you know, addressing certain things with black culture, it's also working as a mystery. And it's also working as a sci-fi mystery, a Twilight Zone episode, if you will.
Yeah.
There's a moment, you know, when this whole cloning thing starts to kick in, you know, then it becomes a very, very surreal sci-fi mystery that works on a comedic level too. And that's what's so beautiful about this is that all these things, you know, they're not working in chunks. They're working in tandem. They're working at the same time in certain scenes sometimes in this film.
Do that. Man, three, I'm gonna bust your shit open. Passed up on my beige bitch, and you went outside and you pulled a 50 cent.
You know, I'm laughing. I'm sitting up here also wondering what is going on, because they do set up the movie gradually keeps setting up these little mysterious plot points, and you are trying to figure out what's happening as the movie moves along.
Right.
You know, not everything is hitting hard at the same time.
Well, but it keeps a level of humor going that you don't know how much to take it seriously until another actor who's not shown here shows up. And that's when it's like, oh shit. And he brings the menace. And then you're like, okay.
Yep.
This is serious now.
Yeah. Yeah, man. The writing and the filmmaking on this is just as good as you know, the comedy that we're talking about here. You know, like I said, all those things work, man. Everything works. And especially the dialogue, man. There's a line in this movie that I'm thinking about to this day. Even when I was putting this together, I was laughing about it. There's somebody managing a fried chicken joint. And the manager looks at his team and said, now remember everybody, there's no I in goddamn. And said it straight face, kind of nonchalantly, and went on about his day. And I was like, wow, man. The dialogue is so funny in here, man. And I like the way the comedy plays into the mystery. You know, you saw kind of in the trailer, people start, you know, they start losing their shit over fried chicken, grape soda.
I was thinking John Boyega right there, like,
and that's funny because the only time he was smiling is when he was eating that chicken.
Yeah. Yeah. He knows some other rest of the movie.
he's smiling hard too. That's some good chicken, boy.
It made me hungry.
Yeah, he almost like Gus Fring is in there. Something. But yeah, you know, these people are enjoying this chicken, these hair care products, this grape soda, acting too stereotypical, man. Mm-hmm. And that's when you start realizing, like, something's wrong. You know, and it's again, it just creeps up on you as you watch the movie. You know, the way the mystery unravels is funny and it's creepy, man, but it keeps you engaged the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's one of the biggest things about this film is that the way they just keep putting little clues out, little hints out here and there, and just kind of making you feel uneasy, you know, but also very curious about what's happening here. Because it is, you know, it's very funny. It's very mysterious, but it's also very creepy.
Yeah.
You know, there's a moment when they start going around in this lab that's in a creepy house in the hood. And, you know, it's almost like they're going through a spook house discovering things, man. And, you know, they're doing all of this while this film feels like a blaxploitation film. But also with this mystery and the sci-fi element, it feels like one of those movies from the 70s or 80s that are like sci-fi films, mm-hmm. like, you know, Soylent Green or They Live or something Planet like of the that. Apes and all yeah, those. You know, and he's, yeah. And the movie really tries to go for that too. You know, it's not just by accident, you know, they're trying to be blaxploitation, or they're trying to address 70s and 80s genre horror films, the sci-fi films, you know, what do you call it? I would even include the remake of Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Sure.
But if you have any doubt that that's a direct reference, not just that movie, but, you know, all these influences I'm talking about, when you watch the movie has, and you can see it in the clip I just showed right here, the movie has a very grainy look on it, man. I don't know if they put a filter on it or whatever, but it has a grainy look like old film. And I knew that they were doing it on purpose because there was a point in the movie where there was a little cigarette burn that popped up in the corner. Mm-hmm. And I was like, all right, because like, listen, this was not shot on film. I can tell you that right now.
Right.
So this is a movie with a lot of messages. This is a you know, it's kind of a heavy film. And they do a great job setting it all up. But it's one of those movies where I think at the end, you know, they did all this great setup and then they just kind of, you know, they had so much going on, they kind of rushed through the end in a way.
You felt that way?
Yeah, because I thought they, you know, because listen, at the end, they have a character comes out and his job is to do nothing but exposition and just kind of explain, you know, the ending instead of, and it really is one of those things of like, if they had more time, if this was a series, it would probably be more show and not telling.
You don't think that's something where maybe they didn't have that and somebody said there's too many people who don't get, who need the wrap up? Because audiences have become used to having a wrap up.
No, I think they could have done it without, I just think that, I'm not saying that people wouldn't have understood it. I just think everything feels crammed and rushed near the end because there's so much that they're doing, you know, they're setting up things in an amazing way, you know? And then we get to the end, it's like, wow, okay, now things are really kind of resolved in the climax. And not fully resolved, but everything just moves so quick. And I'm like, you know, it just doesn't feel as clever. The ending doesn't feel as clever as the explanation. They got something that's great, but the ending just doesn't feel as executed as well as the rest of the film.
That's too bad. I thoroughly enjoyed all that, the ending. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm not saying that I hate it. That's not it at all. I actually, like I said, I think they got some great ideas, and they do some. And you get some actors that pop up, which I'm not going to tell you about, you know, in case you haven't seen the movie already, which is surprising. But yeah, it's just, you know, like I said, it's just me. I just didn't feel like it was as good as the rest of the movie. The more I talk about my criticism of it, I think, you know, the movie was already very overambitious, and it is amazing that it got as far as it did. With, you know, all of his ambitions. And I think it just, you know, all those ambitions didn't come together as well at the end. But that's because the rest of the movie is so great, man.
And it's just great to see black films that are willing to be surreal. I keep talking about this, but so for so many years, black films are just trying to get some quality or get good, but they're always very straightforward. And more we're seeing things where it's like, hey, we've arrived, we can play around and do some things that are high concept.
Yeah, this is a, think of this as a less crazy Boots Riley.
Yeah.
You know, Boots Riley, who I love, I really enjoyed the show, I'm a Virgo. But, you know, there's a point where Boots Riley, he loses his goddamn mind.
Yeah, and I kept expecting this to do that, and it didn't. And maybe that's why I like the ending so much.
Yeah. I think you got a lot of people, black people doing surreal stories now while also having some meaning behind it. You know, Donald Glover with Atlanta.
Sure.
You know, so... Yeah, so there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of people out there taking risk right now. Black surrealism is what somebody said in the chat. But I enjoyed this very much. Hey, we haven't heard much from you. What do you think?
I thought the writing in this movie was brilliant. This movie kind of reminded me of Us and then Get Out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see the Us in there.
And I like that it's making me feel that way. This movie was very funny at the same time. There's also those serious moments that I really did enjoy in this film. The characters, man, John Boyega, I got to give it to you. I have not seen him expand his range because I've only really seen him in Star Wars. But seeing how he's completely opposite here, like, yo, I'm really digging this guy.
I recommend you watch a movie called Attack the Block.
Attack the Block.
Watch Attack the Block and then watch John Boyega today. John Boyega, is, you know, he's British, right?
Yeah, I knew that.
Yeah, so he did a British film called Attack the Block, which I love.
Like his first breakout.
Yeah, yeah, that's one. That's where he first got recognized by a lot of people. Okay. Watch him in that movie and watch where he's come from to far today. He's came. Yeah, that's why he's come. Yeah, he's amazing. I guess probably a low full price.
God damn it!
And that's what?
Yeah, that's gonna say the same thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, I get a low full price because, like I said, I really love the movie. I'm taking something off because of, like, you heard me talk about the ending. That's, if it weren't for that rushed ending, it would be pretty much a very high full price for me. But yeah, that's where I felt like the flaws come in. But fortunately, it didn't last too long. We were almost out. So and they also have a really sort of a great, I don't know, stinger epilogue.
They can go with it.
Yeah, you know, and they open it up for them to keep going, but I don't. I could see it being somewhat of a show if they want to do that. I wouldn't mind exploring this world a little bit more, especially since I thought they wrapped things up too quickly. But either do it as a show or don't do nothing at all, leave it where it is. But anyway.
I would say just leave it alone. I mean, as much as it, you know, it leaves it open, they really said everything they got to say. But yeah, I'm with you. It was a low full price. I liked it a lot. And initially it was a little overhyped for me, but I really got into it. The only negative thing I feel about it in the end is like, well, black people are already prone to believing in conspiracy theories. This don't help.
No, we're gonna go crazy after this one.
Yeah.
It's the white man. Uh-huh. But I guess I'm right there with y'all too. You know what I'm saying?
You sure?
I'm a little bit higher than y'all, but it's just because I feel like the way it ended was to me on a perfect note, or a great note, I should say. I'll give us a full price.
All right. Full price. There you go. All right, y'all. Well, there you go. We talked about Tyrone. Now, shut up.
How long have we been out? Like a month?
Yeah, it's been 3 weeks,
it's
right?
It's been out for about 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, about 2 or 3 weeks. Yeah, because I just got back from, it's been about 2 weeks.
I think it's 3 weeks.
Yeah, I think it was probably about a week.
Because it's fuzzy in my memory now.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I had to kind of.
It came out during Barbenheimer.
Okay.
So however long ago that was.
Oh, yeah, that was true. Yeah, because everybody was like, don't forget about this one.
Yeah. Somebody said it'd be a month on Friday.
Oh, dang. Okay.
Oh.
World, I've seen that movie already.
Yeah. Well.
But they kept asking.
Yeah.
Everywhere I looked, they was like, they're not going to do a review for They Clone Tyrone.
There we go. There you go.
Y'all lucky Dracula stepped out of the way.
Yeah, you and Tyrone, leave us alone.
Call him.
Yeah, to call Tyrone, tell him, leave us alone.
Better leave us alone.
Did you check out the Continental trailer? Wow, who the Cokie?
Yeah, I was gonna say, that's good. It's gotta be a Cokie
song. Damn.
Cokie's in that to me, bro.
Damn, Cokie, you look good, man. Look at that. It buggy beat me, but damn up there. Damn.